Oh, thank you, Amanda. It's so awesome to have Amanda. Amanda was one of my students in youth ministry a while back, but it brings me so much joy to see past students continuing to serve the Lord. So thank you for using your talents and blessing us this morning. My name is Nicole Erbstoser, and I'm also on the women's leadership team for Mom to Mom. And I have the amazing privilege of introducing our speaker. Our speaker and I go way back. We probably met over 10 years ago now, which is crazy. And we were just two young, wild, young adults, loving life and loving Jesus. And I first met Megan at Hume Lake. We had the same job, and we literally got to dress up and run around and be crazy and get kids pumped up about a little thing called recreation. Just a bunch of games. But through that, we built a friendship. And Megan is, why I'm about ready to cry. She just is such a special person in my life. excuse me. Sorry, focus. Megan has, she has a bunch of different jobs. She'll kind of tell you about that. But one of the main reasons how we know her is through Hume Lake, and she is the director of Hume Lake Women's Ministry. And those of you that are joining us and going to this fall's retreat, you're going to be hearing a lot more from Megan. But this morning, we get the privilege to hear from her, and I know it's going to be a super powerful morning, and we've been praying for this morning for many, many months. So I'm just super stoked to invite her up. Get ready to laugh. Get ready to not know really what she's talking about, because she's kind of crazy, but in the best way possible.
Thank you.
Megan is just one of those friends that that one minute you are belly laughing, and the next minute she challenges you in a way, and you're like, oh, yeah, all right, that just rocked me. And she, every time we have a conversation, she points me back to Jesus. And so I'm excited for you to hear from her this morning. So would you guys welcome Megan Faith Marshman.
I love that you started off. And is it normal to do the highs, lows? Is that like the normal thing that you do? That is neat. I don't know who says that word. I do. My husband and I do it every night. And it's so funny. I just had some wisdom from my new neighbor, Heidi. And she was telling us that, like, to prioritize marriage in the midst of having, like, I was just like soaking up wisdom. Because the weird thing is, I have a 1 year old. He's actually 15 months. I have a picture of him. He's over in the little nursery area. I do have one. It's in my wallet, apparently, not on the screen. there he is. And he has a little milk mustache or goatee from, that's my little guy. But I was just, it's so interesting. I love this. When Nicole's telling me about this, like, 6 months ago, maybe even a year ago, she was telling me about this, how this works. You have moms who are peers sitting at the table who basically do like hospitality and care for you. And then there's these mentor moms. And I was thinking, like, how beautiful this church comes alongside you in the most challenging season of your life. I'll just give you a few of my preconceptions about motherhood, and then I'll actually get into the message. This is just kind of fun. Number one, but she told me to prioritize my marriage, and I just thank you for that, Heidi, of prioritizing marriage, because I think I forget. I know that that's a thing, but I forget. Because when you're a mom, you forget everything. You should forget. And then sometimes you feel like a champion because you remembered a few things, and then you're like, I'm the best, and then you fake it for a little bit, and then people realize you're not the best, and then you feel incredibly insecure. It's so weird what motherhood does to you, right? A few things I've just learned about motherhood. Number one, there's something I started to see in my child is that he cries at very inconvenient times. And here's something I love about it and that I've learned from him, that little guy. I've learned that he doesn't have words yet, a few. 10, actually, so beat that, just kidding. We do that, don't we? It's so stupid. But you know what he does when he wants something or when something's not going well is he cries. And I feel like once we become adults or moms, we feel like we can't do that anymore. It's almost like we have to suddenly fake that we're fine. And I love learning that from my son each time he cries. So by the way, next time they cry in a really inconvenient moment, I pray you remember that. Oh, I want to be someone that learns to cry out to the Lord when things are hard. They haven't learned the social cues yet that that's not appropriate. I hope that we, in this place, that it becomes more appropriate to cry out to the Lord and that we're more okay with that. That's the thing I've learned from my son. But based on your wisdom, my husband and I, this is just a random thought that I felt like sharing. We do high of the day, low of the day, and how you saw God today. So maybe you can even adjust that for next week to try something new. But I love it because every week we do this, or every day we do this, and then we end up talking about how we saw God that day, the high of the day, low of the day. And what I love about these questions is the high of the day always tells you how someone likes to be loved. the low of the day typically is telling you how God's trying to work in their life. They just don't usually see it yet. And then the third one, how you saw God that day, is what he is revealing and how you can suddenly connect the three and see that God is actually on the move in your life. So I highly recommend that. And if you do have kids that are old enough to talk or 4 years old, start young. Especially with that third one. I do it with my nieces and nephews. They're 4, 7, 9, and a couple other ages. And I love them all. I know them all. But here's what I love. These kids surprise me like crazy, right? So my little niece, Dora Georgia, we go, hi the day, low of the day, how you saw God today? And I was with her for 2 consecutive days. So day 2, she knew it was coming. I said, okay, Georgia, you know, hi the day, low of the day. And she tells me, and I'm like, it's so cute. And then she gets to how you saw God today. She goes, you know, it's crazy how I saw God today. I'm like, it is. It is. She's like, I saw him while I was swimming. And I was like, okay. She's 9. Like, oh, you saw him swimming? Like, swimming. And she's like, yeah, yeah. Because my little sister, Kate, who doesn't have a personal relationship with God, was just swimming in the shallow end. And that's all she knows. She doesn't even know how, she thinks the deep end is just scary. There's so much more fun to be had in the deep end, but it takes faith, kind of like my faith in God. And I have a faith. And I'm like, yeah, that's how I saw him too. So she's like, so sometimes you just need to jump in and realize you might feel like you're drowning, but it's worth it. It's the adventure of a lifetime. So I can't wait for my sister Kate to come to a relationship with Jesus, and I've never considered her faith before. You haven't? You just haven't considered it? Yeah. Learn from your kids. Come to these groups and learn from each other. There's something in us that wants to know it all, be it all, and we can't. The best thing I've learned in life is to show up everywhere and be a lifelong learner. In fact, the word disciple, what I've realized, if you figure out what the definition of that is just a disciplined learner. If you want to be a disciple, be disciplined to learn. Walk into every environment ready and hungry to learn, especially from your kids. Because there's nothing more faith building in them for than you to see faith in them, learn from them, and they can't wait to show you more. Hey, I have a lot to talk about that had nothing to do with the message. So, but being a mom's hard, let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you for being here with us and addressing all of us inside into the deep core that we don't necessarily want to share with others. So right now, even as we pray, I pray right now, Lord Jesus, that you would begin to peel back layers right now. Oh, I love babies crying. God, this is us. This is our heart's cry. It's just, I need something more. And God, I think we're all in the same place of just needing more of you. So Lord Jesus, would you come? Meet our deepest needs. And all God's children said. I'm going to start with a question that has rocked me for the past year, especially being a mom, and it's a weird question. It's not your normal question. The normal question is, how are you? To which you normally respond, what? Good or fine. And if you say fine, you just kind of hope they don't ask the second question, you know what I mean? But you just hope they kind of don't really care enough to ask the second question. Okay, so, but a friend walked up to me not too, like about actually over a year ago, and she said, hey, Megan, I've been meaning to ask you. And I was like, what? She goes, how's your soul? And I was like, okay. And I tried fine, but there's somehow fine wasn't enough. And the reason I thought about it is because I have a friend who is incredibly famous. I have a famous friend. Has everything. He has everything. He plays professional football. He's like the best at what he does. The best. Yet, his soul is empty. Empty. And I don't know about you, but have you ever gone somewhere and met someone that has nothing, yet their soul is like overflowing? Have you met that person? So with that type of a scale in mind, fellow moms, how's yours? I actually overheard someone use the term over by the food, which good job, who brought those, especially the egg thing with the... Someone over there just used the word empty, and I have a feeling she's not alone. Tired. Exhausted. Or fine, which basically, for me at least, when I use that one, translates just kind of getting through. Waiting for whatever's next. I believe Jesus wants to touch our soul. Whether we've been following him for our entire lives or whether you don't even necessarily know what it means to follow him, I believe he wants to address our souls and see what might happen. My life illustration, if you've ever heard me speak, you've probably heard me give this life illustration, but it's changed as I've become a mom, and it's that of a cup. In a sense, it's a metaphor for my soul. And so I would run around. So like literally Nicole and I's job at this camp was to just love people. That was our job. And then weirdly get people to scream when we'd do our hands like this, and then we'd get them to quiet down. And it was this weird power that we had. But I loved, if you've been to Hume, you understand, you're like, yes, I screamed every time you raced. It's weird. But what I loved about my job is I just got to like splash love on, there's stuff in it. I just got to like splash love on people. That was it. And then I'd run around and I'd splash love on people, and I realized I had done this my entire life. This wasn't just unique to this camp. See, I'd grown up rather outgoing, and I would splash love on my sister, my mom, and my sports teams, and my teachers, and I was running. When I first came up with this illustration, it's changed as I've become a mom, by the way. What I would do is I'd go, yes, I would splash love, and then I'd run over with my quiet time with Jesus, fill up a little bit, and then I'd, you know, like go over here and I'd splash love. But to be honest with you, I created a really bad habit in that I would take my then empty cup and hold it out in the direction of people to be filled up by their opinions of me. Hence empty. Hence tired. Hence I'd rather be distracted than aware of what I'm really thinking. And then I had a kid, and as recent as yesterday morning, I was doing it again. Sitting with my little guy and holding out how I am in his direction. He's gonna play a really crappy savior. Because he can't fix what's gone wrong with my soul. The illustration has changed. Because I used to think that I had to go and then, okay, and then I got to run and have quiet time. But it was almost as if I would splash love and have this empty time. And now here's what I've recognized, that being a mom means this. You take your cup from the direction of people, places, ideas, jobs, hopes, dreams. You take it away from those things, those savior-like expectations. You take it away from those things. You tilt it upward the way a cup was designed to sit, to be filled inward, that you might overflow outward. And then that's where I believe what it means to walk in step with the Spirit. You don't have to run anymore. And if you're walking in step with God, then suddenly you're just overflowing to people what they actually need, which is not you. This might be humbling, but the world does not need you. It needs him. Needs him. And we'll miss it if we're holding out our cup in the direction of people who are only holding out their cup in our direction. And our job as moms, you want to know what it is not to change your kids. God doesn't call you to change your kids. He calls you to love them and then entrust him with the changing, which means you show him where your cup is. And suddenly you're calm in the midst of his crazy, which suddenly means you just simply are overflowing. So that's why I believe Jesus wants to address our souls. And I believe he wants to address our souls in a very specific way through the most exciting message of all. When Nicole and I first talked about this time and what specifically to share, I thought about, like, I could share every embarrassing story, vulnerable story, all the times I've cried, the moments I've been up at 3 a.m. crying, literally learning to pray out loud because I want him to understand that what I want him to do in moments of chaos is pray out loud. So I'm like, dear, I become preacher in the middle of the night. Dear Jesus, play. As soon as last night when suddenly he lost his diaper in the middle of the night, where did it go? No one knows, but Megan, we've been meaning to share with you. We're so sorry about the crib you loaned us. But I believe he wants to share a really important word with you, and it happens to be this thing that's really good news, and it's referred to as the gospel. If you've followed Jesus any length of time, this for you is really great news. And if you've never in your entire life chosen to follow Jesus, this is really good news. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to the book of Romans, chapter 1. Romans is written by a guy named Paul. Paul has quite a past. Paul reminds me to never stop praying for people, because God can do whatever he wants with whomever he wants, whenever he wants, on his own timing. Do not stop praying. Paul wrote this letter called to a church, to a Roman church, and he wrote this letter, and here's what he does. He basically outlines this entire book in one book of the Bible. So that's Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, then you get to Romans. Romans chapter 1, it starts just how the entire beginning of the story starts. It says this, chapter 1, verses 19. Since what may be known about God is plain to them because God has made it plain to them. For since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that men are without excuse. So what he does is he gives the entire narrative of this entire one story, which, by the way, we're a part of. And he gives it, and it starts with God. It doesn't start with us. Now, that might feel really obvious to you. In fact, if you've read any portion of this book, you know that in the beginning, it says God. Like any good book, it starts with the main character. You know what it doesn't say? In the beginning, you. In the beginning, your kids. Like, this might be the most obvious point, but I promise you, if you take it literally, it would change a lot. God is the main character of this story. It's not about you, but this story absolutely involves you. And moms, I have something really important to share. Your part in this story is significant. I don't know what you think about that word, but for some reason, there's something in me very deeply that wants to be significant. And you'll catch a vision of what God has when you recognize who the story is about. What I mean by it would change everything is it literally would. It would change even how you read this book. Have you ever opened up the book and done this? Inspire me. Okay, you still don't get it. Okay. Yes? If you open up this book to find inspiration, motivation, you might be disappointed, because you're making yourself the main character of the quiet time. If you open up this book to find God, you will never be disappointed, because it's all about him and he's all over it. If you're not the main character of your life, then when you walk into a coffee shop and you're not the main character, then suddenly it's not about just getting your coffee order. Because what might God do with that time? If it's all about him, it means you walk up. I run a young adults ministry, and they all happen to work at coffee shops. So I started to ask questions like, how do people actually love you? They go, when they acknowledge that I'm not here just to serve them and their story. I'm like, what does that practically look like? Because I thought Megan shared a really profound thing. Just love God, love others, love your family. That's it. It's just that simple. And that will happen if you understand who the main character is. So now I walk into a coffee shop. Hey, how are you? By the way, it shocks them every time. They're like, what? What can I get you? I'm like, yeah. How are you? Fine. Then they look at the line behind you. What can I get you? Oh, I'm so sorry. An ice skinny vanilla latte, but and hold the phone. Just kidding. I'm not that person. But, and then the next time I see them, I remember a thing that they said the time before, so they can feel loved, because it's not about me. Every moment. If we understood this, because the problem with the world, the chaos that happens, see, in the beginning, God created and it was perfect. How do you know that? Because you look around and creation screams creator, it says in Romans. But the problem was, we, verse 25, exchanged the truth of God for a lie and worshiped and served created things rather than the Creator who is forever praised. Amen. We exchanged the truth of God for a lie. See, the serpent came in the very beginning, page 3, came in and gave us a lie. Here's the lie. You can be in control. You can be your own God. Don't be needy. You can be in control. Have we been, and by the way, I think we've been believing that lie ever since. So we began to worship and serve created things rather than the Creator who is forever praised. And by the way, it's not just you. Chapter 3 says this, verse 23. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. All. I actually circled it. Here's why. Because I can walk into a room like this as a mom, and if I happen to be carrying my baby, you're playing that comparison game the entire time. And I believe that Teddy Roosevelt was right when he said comparison is the thief of all joy. You will miss what God is doing when you play the comparison game. But as moms, we do it, and I feel crazy right now. There's something, and if you can relate to that crazy feeling you have, but you're constantly just playing that game. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Because here's the reality of something we all have in common. There is a perfect standard in order to be in a relationship with a perfect God. You have to be perfect. But we all have fallen short. So do me a favor and look to a mom on your right and your left and say, fellow mom. Go ahead. And now look to your second choice and say, I'm just kidding. Now go like this, fellow mom, I am so glad. Good, 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 good. Last one. Fellow mom, I am so glad that you're as jacked up as I am. Welcome to Mom to Mom. We're the thing we haven't. People are like celebrating sin. Awesome. So, welcome to Mom, where you walk in and go, here's the deal. It's hard. This week was hard. I held out my cup the entire week. And he didn't live up to my perfect expectations, and I forgot that we all fall short. All. I feel like very ungathered until I, and I'm so like, I want it, to be honest with you, I want to jump back into like, gathered version. But you can't relate to gathered version, can you? You can relate to desperate version. And in fact, desperate version is much more compelling than fake perfect version when it comes to moms. Because guess what? There is a perfect standard and you fell short and so did she. So is that the end of the story? Heck no. You see, on page 3, there was 4 broken relationships. On page 3, God said, I'm enough. People, the first people ever, didn't believe that God was actually enough. They believed they had to be the ones that were enough. And there was 4 broken relationships. Number 1, there was a broken relationship between a perfect God and imperfect people. Secondly, there was suddenly a broken relationship between people. Because 2 people believed that they were the center of the universe. And so suddenly, if you notice, the universe works because there's 1 central orbit. When you have 2 people with central orbits, you want to know whenever there's conflict in your marriage, it's because 2 people are prioritizing themselves as the main character. When you both center yourself on the 1 central orbit, you can finally find yourself in unity and find a flow. Number 2, broken relationship with people. Number 3, a broken relationship with ourself. Sounds kind of confusing, but I'll say this. In chapter 2, verse 25, it says in the book of Genesis, the very beginning, that they were naked and unashamed. I can't even imagine. I carry shame all day from my past. But there was a time when people, the first 2, who walked around and were the only people, I believe, that ever got to experience what life would have been like without being self-conscious. By the way, do you know that it's possible? It's possible to walk into a room like this and not just be merely aware of yourself. It's possible. And not only is it possible, it's the best possible life. You see, because the story, by the way, the third thing was a broken view of ourself, and the fourth thing was a broken relationship to the ground, because work used to be just delightful. 4 broken things happened, but the story doesn't stop there. The story continues. In fact, the story also, just remember, doesn't start with sin, and it also doesn't end with sin. And Romans, again, does a great job capturing it. Chapter 1, God created everything, and it was perfect. Chapter 3, you all, same page, you fell short. Chapter 5, verse 8 says this. But God... You will see these 2 words all throughout Scripture, and you better smile every time because God butts into the story. But God, in the midst today of you living for you, God butts in because he knows that's not the best for you. but God did not just say that he loved. Because have you ever met people that say that they love, yet they don't act like they love? Me too. Some of you have family members that say it a whole lot. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. I memorized this one in elementary school. But I'll be honest with you. I didn't oftentimes ask hard questions of the Bible. I didn't ask deep questions because, to be honest, I was content with a very shallow faith. So we're going to ask some hard questions. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were sinners, Christ died. Why did Jesus Christ have to die? Have you ever asked that one? Because I think it's something that I had memorized a majority of my life, right? What does it mean to follow Jesus? It means to believe that Jesus died on the cross for my sins. Why did he have to die? Oh, glad you asked. Chapter 6 says this, verse 23. For the wages. What does the word wages mean? Good. I'm so grateful for your feedback. Yes. Not everyone. Calm down. Wages. What is that? We know that term.
Payment.
You're just due. What you earn. Yes. What you're just due. What you earn, the wages of sin, what you earn for having your life revolve around you is this: death. Not just physical death. Inevitably, you will die. By the way, when God created and it was perfect, death was not in that scenario. But what we earned is death. Not just physical death. Inevitably, we will all physically die. But spiritual death. A separation from God. We earned a separation from God. The wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus. See, here's the deal. Death is the only thing that can pay that penalty. What we earned is death. Jesus Christ came down to earth and lived a perfect life, fully God, fully man. And in living a perfect life, he alone earned a perfect relationship with the Father. Because in order to be in a perfect relationship with the Father, you have to be perfect. You see, every world religion, every single world religion in the entire world has a metaphorical ladder. It's a ladder that literally is just like a typical ladder of people trying to climb their way to God. Everyone knows there's a gap. There's something missing. There's something that's not the way it should be. And every single world religion has a ladder. Some have literal, when you get to this step, you do this much, you get to this step. You do this much, you get to this step. If you made that mistake, you drop down again. And people are constantly climbing, even in the book of Genesis, the Tower of Babel, people trying to climb their way to be in a relationship with God. Because in order to be there, you have to be perfect. So we try to perfect ourselves, try to do enough, be enough, make sure that we are impressive enough and more important enough than other people, and we're trying to constantly get ahead. Christianity also has a ladder, but it's also one of the distinctives of Christianity versus every other faith religion in the entire world. And it has to do with the holiday we just celebrated. You see, God knew that we could not climb up the ladder to get to him. So, God climbed down the ladder to be with us. That's Christmas. That's the significance of a baby 2,000 years ago. And that baby grew up to be a man who lived a perfect life and earned the perfect relationship. We earned death. The reason Jesus died is because he took that which we earned. And if we put our faith and trust in his saving work, taking what we deserve, he gifts us through grace what he deserves, which is a perfect relationship with God. You can't earn it. Jesus did. That's why you choose to put your faith and trust in his earning of that. which means you can be free from trying to earn it. You can recognize the gift and then live your life in response. You see, Jesus died, took that which we deserved. And on the third day, he rose from the grave, proving two things. Number one, he is God. Number two, Jesus Christ rose from the dead and proved he has the power to make dead things alive. The wages of our sin is death. Jesus has the power to make you fully alive today. And fully alive, I believe, looks like him. Not living for yourself, but living for him. And it's one of the most freeing things. I can't imagine walking through motherhood another day simply living for me with my cup in my son's direction. It's exhausting. You see, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. And what happens as a result? Chapter 8, it says this, and I feel like for moms we need to hear this. Therefore, verse 1, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Shame and guilt. You know what my least favorite phrase, and if you say it, don't feel guilty. That would defeat the purpose. But is the phrase, shame on you. In the name of Jesus, I get the power to say, shame off you. Shame off you. I know you haven't done it perfectly, but shame off you, because Jesus is more powerful than your pain, and sin is ugly. Shame off you. You haven't done it perfectly. Shame off you. You've prioritized yourself. Shame off you. You've made it all about your kids. Shame off you. You haven't prioritized your marriage. Shame off you. You couldn't earn your way to God. Shame off you. Jesus rose from the grave. Shame off you. Will you let it go? Will you release and say, yes, your cross is more powerful than my shame? Because it is. Shame off you. There is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, which means this. I literally think of the picture in Christ Jesus like this. You can stand in having a perfect family, and if that perfect family shatters, so do you, because you're standing in it. If you stand in having a perfect job at the perfect time with the perfect boss who appreciates you perfectly, and something doesn't work out, it shatters, so do you. If you stand in anything that has the potential to shatter, so will you. When you stand in Christ, when it shatters, you don't. But he was shattered for you. He's different than everything else. That's living life in Christ Jesus. You see, Jesus earned a perfect relationship. So when God the Father, the minute you choose to put your faith and trust in him and not yourself and your ability to get there, then when God the Father looks at you, he doesn't see your sin. He looks at you, and that's why in the book of Ephesians, you should read that one this week, chapters 1, 2, and 3 talk about who Jesus is, which is who you are in him. That's why Paul refers to you in this other book called Ephesians as, listen for it, blameless, pure, holy, which means set apart, loved, adopted, heirs to the throne. Everything Jesus is, you become when you put your faith and trust. In fact, what do you do with this? If you're someone that's like, this is intriguing, I've actually never heard this whole thing of what Jesus really did on my behalf. Great, I'm glad you asked, because chapter 10, it continues. Verses 9 through 11, it says this, that if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. That if you confess with your mouth, Jesus, you are Lord, not me, and believe in your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified. And it is with your mouth that you confess and are saved. As scripture says, anyone who trusts in him will never be put to shame. This is good news, my friends. And then how do you live in response? Of course, he continues, chapter 12. Says this, therefore, and every time you read the word therefore, you always want to ask what it's there for. Every time. So if you're wondering, let me recap it again. Chapter one, God created everything. It was perfect. That includes you, and everything he creates on purpose with a purpose. He doesn't create without a purpose. So stop believing that lie. Whew. God created everything. It was purpose. We made our lives about us. That's chapter three, chapter five. But God would not leave us even today just living for us. He has something so much better. And he made it possible for that better for us to be in a relationship with him. And he did it through Jesus' death and resurrection. Resurrection means comes to life, because he wants you to follow in his ways, to die to yourself and come to life. Come to him. And if you do, there is suddenly no shame. How do you do it? You confess he's Lord and not me. Therefore, I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy. What's God's mercy? Chapter one. To offer your bodies as living sacrifices. And I feel like no audience understands that more than a mom. Holy and pleasing. Here's a key. To God. Pleasing God trumps pleasing people. This is your spiritual act of worship. Do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you'll be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. You live your life for him in response to him giving his life. And the best news is Jesus doesn't ask us to do anything he hasn't already done himself. Why does he ask for our life? Because he gave us his. Why does he ask for sacrifice? Because he sacrificed everything. Everything he asks of us, he's already given to us as an example. My son's life started off a little shaky. After 30 hours of labor, I don't even know if that's like extreme. It was just, yeah, rough. I mean, it was rough. Okay. We got to the hospital at about 8 hours in. And then they started throwing all these weird things. These alarms kind of all went off in my room. Doctors rushed in and it got a little bit crazy. When I delivered my son, he wasn't breathing. And I remember they had the NICU team. You know what that stands for, but it just says bad news. Neonatal Intensive Care Unit. Wow, I do. They just had him standing by, and I remember not knowing what was going on. I felt so helpless. There's just these people. I have him. I want to see him. They rush him. And I'm like, and I can see him through about six doctors who are beginning to shove all these little tubes down his mouth. And I'm like, what is, and my husband's grabbing my face. I'm like, no, but what, like, what is, I don't understand what's happening. He's like, don't freak out. He's not breathing. And then suddenly I feel my mom slapping my face. And I'm like, mom, because they were slapping his back to try to get him to breathe. And I'm like, and this, I've actually never told this to moms. It's so weird. And I remember like feeling the slaps and I'm like, what is happening? And my mom's like, wake up. And I'm like, what is happening? It took about 15 minutes to get that little guy breathing. They got him breathing. And then they had to rush him off to somewhere else. And I remember my husband, they're like, do you want to be with your wife or do you want to be with the son? So then my husband's like, I'm going to be with my wife, right? So he runs over and I'm like, go be with our son. He's like, okay, orders, you know, so he runs. I appreciate his decision to prioritize our family and our marriage, but he went to go be with our boy. My husband's a nurse. And I remember he's FaceTiming and I'm like, just a wreck. I feel all alone. I feel isolated. They wheel me into that like next room, which is like your room. And I happen to get one where you share a room. Awesome. And the woman is freaking out because she can't get her son to stop crying. Now, mind you, is that valid? Yes. She's a new mom. She has no idea. But I'm freaking out because my son's not in the room. All I see is a woman going, me, 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 me. And I saw it in myself. My husband like rushes in. He's like, okay, so he's breathing. We can go see him in about an hour. They're gonna do some like crazy stuff. I'm like, I didn't even understand anything. And he goes, did we get the car seat in the car? And I'm like, and I was like, well, actually there's two car seats, yeah. He's like, oh my gosh, did we do the crib? And I was like, yeah, we built it together, you know.
He's like, did we get the base thing that goes underneath the car seats so that you don't have to like strap them in and it's just kind of crazy with the seatbelt? I'm like, we got two bases. He's like, you didn't bring clothes, did you? And I'm like, I like look over, I'm like, just the cutest ones. I just bought the cutest clothes. Like, I did left the ones we don't like that we're going to take back, cut home. He's like, you didn't by chance prepare his room and decorate it with that one poster because he lives in a 5'5" room. That's fine. But you didn't by chance decorate his room. I'm like, I got a really cool poster. And I had no idea where he's going with this. I'm like, yeah, I got a cool poster. He's like, are we prepared? I'm like, we're prepared. He goes, we're prepared with everything except one thing. Megan, we forgot one thing. I'm like, what did we forget? We forgot that we need God to be parents. We need to entrust our son to God. Are you willing? And usually, before I was a mom, that's an easy question. But as a mom, it felt very different. I was like, I'm willing. And we started to pray, and my husband's like, Jesus, he's yours, and we trust you with him. And I start praying for the salvation of the woman. And we pray, and we realize the type of parents we want to be is not ones that allow the world to revolve around us individually, or even to have the world revolve around us as a family, but to entrust that whatever God might have, highs of the days, lows of the days, and everything in between, to allow our son to go through whatever needs to happen in order for him to understand a deeper relationship, that there is a God who, one, created him on purpose, that two, in the midst of my son who right now already understands sin and the fact that the world revolves around him, that's all he knows, to understand that there is a but God in that story. That he comes and he so loved my son that he sent his own son, gave his own life for my son. That if my son puts his faith and trust in Jesus, that he can come to life, not merely living for himself. And as moms, I think suddenly we care about ourselves because we care about our kids. But I think sometimes we care about our kids and forget about ourselves. So let me invite you into something deeper, and I promise you that deeper is God's good for you. Responding, shame offing, to the one who gave us this entire life and asking for ours in response. To move from making our lives about us to recognizing he gave his life for us that we might be in a perfect relationship, that we might, as moms, step deeper, tilt our cup upward to be overflowing outward the thing our kids actually need. And it's not a perfect mom. They need a desperate mom who needs Jesus to show them that they can be desperate and need for Jesus too. Because they will shatter trying to be perfect. They will shatter finding their identity in anything else. So my friends, let me invite you to join me in becoming more desperate for Jesus and taking a moment to entrust our kiddos to whatever God might have for them. And that is a scary prayer. It takes a deep trust and a deep faith, not in our abilities to get them there, but in God's desire to have them there. Will you pray with me? Heavenly Father, I thank you for this good news that we don't merely have to live for ourselves, and you created a way for us not to live for ourselves. Thank you for kids and how suddenly it makes us think about things that matter. And with every eye still closed, I simply just want to talk to you all on the chairs for a second. I believe, like Romans chapter 12, every time we hear from God, we are called to respond. So very simply, I have two thoughts on ways that we could possibly respond to this message. And number one is you're in this room, and the reason I have you have your eyes closed is it's sometimes hard to get alone.
So in a space alone between you and God, I just want to pray for a few of you. That's it. I believe every time we open God's word, he's calling us to respond. So before I give this two specific responses, I want to invite everyone in this room to respond with this simple question. A question asked to you and God, this question: God, how are you calling me to respond to this message? Take a second. God, how are you calling me to respond to this good news? First response, just a group of people that I really want to pray for. And by the way, I want you simply to raise your hand in a second. And some of you are like, I'm over that, because I'd prefer to be fine. I'll say this. Simply raising your hand in this moment, when I ask a few simple questions, I might just say, hey, I want to be more desperate. But if you're in this room and you, specifically that shame piece, you're at a place where you just want shame off of you and you've been carrying shame. I have no idea your story. But if you're a mom, maybe you followed Jesus for a very long time or a short time, but you know you've been carrying shame that you don't have to carry. I just want to pray for you. If that's you, if you just simply slip up your hand so I can pray for you. So Heavenly Father, I pray for each of these women, even as they raised their hand, just simply stating, I just want to put my hands up. And I pray for these women specifically that they would, not in just putting their hands up, that they would actually release the shame they've been carrying. Not just release it just generally into the air, but release it to you. So Lord Jesus, I pray for the power of your Holy Spirit to continue moving in them, their being, that this wouldn't just be a momentary feeling, but this would be a true reality. Lord, set them free. And there's a second group of people maybe who are in this room who've never put their faith and their trust in Jesus, and they've been only putting their faith and trust in themselves, and they're exhausted. If that's you, I just simply want to pray for you. Maybe you heard this stuff about Jesus, and you've maybe heard about Jesus for a very long time, and you know that you need Jesus. But maybe you're in this room and you all you have is a ton of questions. I'm not going to lead you in some magical prayer. I'm just going to say that if you're in this room and you've never put your faith in Jesus and you know that you need Jesus, again, you have a ton of questions, but you simply want prayer to take the next step, whatever that step is for you, but you're in this room and you've never put your faith in Jesus, but you know that you need him, I simply want to pray for you. So if that's you, would you mind raising your hand so I can pray? Awesome. Heavenly Father, I pray. Jesus, I believe you initiate. So the fact that you're making people's heart beat right now, I just thank you. And I pray, Lord, that as we jump into discussion with a group of women who are just as imperfect as us, that we would feel no shame. And maybe we would open up on the things that we try to hide. And Lord, I pray for salvation in this place. That you'd bring people into a deep relationship, specifically the people that raised their hand. Would you bring them close, and not just close? Would you step in their place and invite them into something, a new life? I pray, Lord Jesus. And Lord, I thank you for each woman here, and I pray for courage in the next few minutes as we jump again into discussion. Worship first. Worship of you, because this is your good news. First, may we worship, and then may that worship lead us to worship you through honesty with each other. I thank you for this place, this building, this time, these tables, these chairs that are set in place that we might confess you as Lord. Share the hard things and learn how to love. We love you, Jesus. You are worthy of all of our praise. And all your children said. meaningful. So again, I'm really happy you guys are here. As we were talking in our back table about just a few different things, one thing, how we can sustain this desperation and wanting to entrust our kids to the Lord, I wanted to teach you the thing that someone taught me. So this is not original to me. Someone taught me to do with my kid, just to remind myself that he's his. The way I do it is what's called a blessing. So a blessing, it's found all throughout scripture. In Genesis chapter 12, Abraham is told that he's going to be blessed to be a blessing. So if anything, God's taught you anything, it's never meant to stop with you ever. It always is meant to go through you to someone else. So God has blessed us with the gift of salvation, yes. And so we can give that gift away to other people. And the way that I do it as a parent is I give my child a blessing. So a blessing, if you've ever been to a church service, they give usually a benediction at the end, or they'll send you out with a blessing. It's basically a prayer is directed at God. A blessing is directed at a person. So you can look at someone, not just pray over them, but you can look at someone and tell them a truth. And if you know anything about God's word, you can tell them words God could have for them. If you say anything from God's word, you can trust that it's God's word to them. Does that make sense? So I think we can get kind of crazy with the God told me to tell you. Well, if it's from God's word, then he did tell you to tell them because it's what he says. So what a blessing is, I don't know you, but if you'd come on stage real fast, what's your name?
Gail.
Gail, come on. So first, thank you. Just like leaped up there. That was good. Okay, so what you do is very simply, and I do this for me rhythmically. I do this every time I lay him down for a nap. You put your hand on the shoulder. So Gail, if you'd look at me, do you mind if I put my, perfect. So I'm going to put my hand on her shoulder, and then I'm going to start with her name because names matter. You put your hand on the shoulder, and then you simply say the name Gail. And an easy way to do it, you can either read scripture over them, you can do a lot of things, but one thing I love doing is just finishing this sentence. May you know, fill in the blank. So, Gail, may you know that your Heavenly Father loves you. And he sees you. And is with you, moving through you, but he's constant. Our God is constant. And then typically I like praying, so Heavenly Father, would you simply thank you for the fact that Gail, I'm sure in many avenues of her life, has been constant for so many people. So Lord, I pray for rest for her to find constant time with you, not just set aside space, but just a constant moving in step with you. Lord, I thank you that she loves you. Thank you for inviting her into a relationship. But I pray, Lord, for added courage to step courageously into unknown places, trusting that in even though places and people aren't constant, you are. We love you, Lord Jesus. Amen. So I do this every night. Every night, every time he goes down for, and it's because he has this little shoulder, I'm like, deep, faster. Like, and he doesn't even look at me, but it's beautiful. And I'll let you know, I have to, and I'm going to have you guys practice with each other. I know, crazy. But I have to give you two warnings. So number one, watch your expectations. I remember the first time I was taught a blessing and I was like, I got to try this. So I found my sister's kid. So my nephew, I'm like, Landon, come here. And he's like on the playground. He like runs over and I'm like, okay, so. Landon. And he literally like leaned back. I'm like, no, come closer. You know? And I'm like, may you know. And then I stopped and asked God what he needed to know. May you know that God and your family love you. And he goes, I know. And runs away. I'm like, so Heavenly Father, I pray. And it's like, second time, like a week later, I'm like, Landon comes over thinking it's gonna be a fun game because that's what we usually do. I'm like, one thing I love, he said, I know again and ran off. One thing I love though is that he does know. And in a world where like, you feel like you need to prove why you're worthy of love, I'm happy that he knows that he just is. And now he's hungry for it. Next expectation moment. I taught this at a conference up at Hume, and a woman was like, okay, I'm going to go do this. My kid's 16. By the way, if you have a kid that's like 12 to 18 or above, if you have any kid that's in that age range, just know if you haven't done it for 12 years, yeah, it's going to be awkward the first time. Okay, so I remember this woman's like, okay, so it's actually not even my son. I married, and he had a son. She goes, and he won't even let me touch him. Like, he always has shuddered when I touch him. She goes, but I'm going to try this. You said. I'm like, oh, crap. No, don't do it. She's like, okay. She comes back a year later, and here's the story. First night, she gets in. He's like 14. He's in his room, and she's like, she shuts off the light. She's like, Jason, your Heavenly Father loves you. And she like runs away. And he's like, and I can imagine him going, well, that was weird. You know, and then every night, she's always, I'd always say it for the first like month. I said it from outside. I was like, Jason, God is real. Just know that. And then she's like, right away. Jason, may you know God is powerful, more powerful than people's words of you. His word is more powerful over you. Let it be true. And he usually just didn't respond. After a month, she goes, I'm stepping inside. So she couldn't even see him, but she was there. Jason, may you know, and she'd stop. May you know that our God is love. You don't have to look anywhere else. Jason, may you know our God knows you and forgives you. Just run to him, ask for it. Jason, may you know. After the second month, she's like, okay, lights on. She tells the story 6 months later. She walked up and she said it was the very first time she had ever placed her hand on her son's shoulder and he didn't flinch. First time. 9 months later, she's downstairs. She just forgot. And she hears this, Mom! Which for her was a real big deal because he usually didn't call her that. She comes in. You forgot to bless me. She comes and tells a story, and she's like weeping, and I'm weeping, and we're praising God. But just know, if you haven't done it for 13 years, it might be a shock to a 13-year-old, especially a 16-year-old, let alone an 18-year-old. But I'll say this, you might be surprised that you yourself need to be blessed. So here's what I would love to do. I would love to have, this is going to be crazy, but this is the best place to practice. You have very grace-filled people. But I'll say, we're going to stand up, and we're just going to bless people. As we exit, and then I'll pray a blessing. And this, is it scary? Yes. Yes, it is. Yes, it is. Are you going to wonder who's going to see you? And it's not about you for this moment. And here's the best part. Rather than waiting for someone to see you and want to come up to you to bless you, just take one step back and go, God, who can I go find? Take a step back and go, it's all about you. I do that before I walk into any room, because I know that if I just walk into a room in my own strength, I'm going to be thinking, who sees me? Who notices me? Who cares about me? People are, okay, they're in a little thing. I can't really walk into that conversation. Okay. So, and then I'm constantly self-conscious. No. Don't let that happen. Walk in and go, God, what do you have? Use my hands to hug who needs to be hugged, my eyes to see who needs to be seen, my feet to take me to the places you would have me go for your glory. So in this moment, I'm going to have you all stand, and right now you could feel incredibly intimidated. Stand up. Or you could just wait. I want you to receive one blessing and give one blessing. Let me remind you how it goes. You ask them their name. If you don't know their name, they have a name tag. You're welcome. If you still don't know their name, ask. It's not too late to ask their name. Do not be offended if someone asks you your name. It means they care to know it. And simply a hand on the shoulder, look them in the eyes, their name, may you know. And before you speak, ask God for a word to come to mind, something. And then here's the hardest part for a mom. Would you receive that as if God wants to tell you that? Would you receive it in that way? Tell one, receive one. So it'll go, the name, on the shoulder. Yeah, we're doing the shoulder thing. May you know, pause, and then just do one sentence. Don't get wordy. Don't get preachy. One sentence, and then a one sentence prayer. And if it's the person back to you or you want to move around, doesn't matter. Everyone has to receive one and give one, and then I'll send us out with a blessing. Go ahead. I mean, kids' eternities are for, you know, just kidding. But if you do, they hand out this thing called a home front weekly. If you guys, yes? Hey! On the bottom right corner is a blessing for the week given. And that home front, what it is it sets you up to be the primary disciplers of your children. Don't feel overwhelmed by an entire sheet of to-do lists. Pick one thing and do it. Just one per week, just do it. That's a way you can partner with this children's ministry, come alongside. And then they give a suggested blessing. So you'll see the variety of which we teach how to do that, which is really cool. So it's fun. Very rarely do I get to speak at places that use this curriculum, which is awesome. Woo! So true curriculum. It happens here. Drop off your kids. They're being blessed. So, my friends, would you, and by the way, what we always have the little kids do when they receive a blessing is hold out their hands, which I really like this posture of receiving, especially as a woman that gives a lot. Would you just receive these words? And by the way, there's little kids, this one group of four-year-olds, they always receive the blessing. And I saw this one little girl do this once. She goes, because she wanted to make sure the blessing got into her heart. And it's true. I don't want kids, I don't want this, the stuff we talked about today to just sit in your mind. What a miss. So ladies here, if you'd extend your hands wherever you're seated, standing, whatever, and if there's little babies that you're holding, perfect, would you receive this blessing? May you know that your Heavenly Father His love is overwhelming. Life doesn't have to be so overwhelming. And I have this picture of His overwhelming love, like the story of Noah washing away everything else that feels very overwhelming, so you can step into that having been swarmed with His love. So women, would we become empowered? Would I pray for this like weird strength? And I pray we give you credit for it. As we step into whatever's next, to the places we pick up our little nuggets and look them in the little eyes, and then they look away. Would we have courage to still speak your words over them, to hold them? And I pray specifically for that hard moment. Someone's going to have a hard moment today. And I pray that they would have the courage to invite you into that hard moment, to not try to accomplish it alone, and then to call someone from this group. God, I thank you for this group. Be glorified. We are blessed to be a blessing, so may it get into our hearts and overflow into our families. We love you, Jesus. And all God's children said, cool.